We're here with Miro Copic, co-founder of Bottom Line Marketing and marketing lecturer at SDSU. Thanks for joining us, Miro.
Thanks, Maya.
Let's start with your area of expertise, especially shopping. As the holidays approach, a major local mall has some big changes on the horizon. Tell us what's happening with Fashion Valley Mall.
Fashion Valley is making its first makeover since the big makeover in 1997, where they added the second story. What they're trying to do is make sure that both for tenants and for visitors, the mall experience is far better. Fashion Valley has over 200 stores. 50 stores of those 200 are only San Diego exclusive stores. That means they rely on Fashion Valley for most of their income. And so the Simon companies, who are the owners of the 50% owners of the mall and operate the mall, they are really looking to transform all the malls they have worldwide. They have over 230 properties. Fashion Valley is a major regional mall. It gets a lot of traffic from Mexico, and it is the super luxury mall. So it has anchor stores like Bloomingdale's, Neiman Marcus, and Nordstrom's, plus very exclusive shops like Louis Vuitton. So they get traffic, but they want people to stay longer. There's gonna be more restaurants, and it's gonna be a much better experience. Fashion Valley and these mall operators have to compete against the Amazons of the world as we're going into the holiday shopping window.
And I understand the shops will be staying open during the construction
all,
as well.
Yes.
And then in consumer prices, we saw a spike recently, and gas prices played a part in that. Can you tell us what else is at play here?
Yeah, it's, you know, the economic data is so crazy in the last few months, but the consumer price index for the last month went up 0.4%, which would suggest almost a 5% inflation rate, which is very unusual for the last 25 years, where we've had a very low inflation rate environment. Mm-hmm. Driving that was gas prices, first and foremost. As we saw last month, there was a big spike in gas prices. Secondly, medical costs. Third, dining out. The downside and the yellow flags that are kind of signaling here is not only we do have a good, robust economy and low unemployment, but the manufacturing sector is in contraction. Services are slowing down in terms of their growth. And then the trade war with China, which was really optimistic last week to possible resolution, this week took a turn for the worse. This means that on December 15th, new tariffs will go into effect. Tariffs that were supposed to go up will go up, and that means that over $1,000 a year in increased costs for the average family is going to continue.
And we're going to continue to talk about that as well.
Yep.
Now, finally, a story that got a lot of buzz this week, Disney Plus. It launched a bit of a rocky start with the rollout. Tell us more.
You know, Disney Plus, this is the we're in full-scale streaming war mode at this moment. Mm-hmm. Disney Plus is a highly anticipated service because it includes not only Disney content, but ESPN and Hulu. So for $7 a month, it's a very reasonable cost. They had over 2 million people, or close to 2 million, that pre-ordered. Over 10 million signed up in the first day. It crashed the servers, so people were getting, your videos interrupted messages. They posted it all on social media. Disney has since corrected it, but they really drove this because they're in competition with companies like Netflix or Amazon, because you get Amazon streaming through your Amazon Prime membership. And they're looking for 60 to 90 million subscribers by 2024. They got a fifth or sixth of that on day one. They get the Marvel movies, the Star Wars movies, the Disney movies, the Pixar movies. Disney also recently bought the Fox content. So all the Simpsons shows, 30 seasons, are on this channel. What we see in research is consumers are willing to pay for three or four streaming services. So really trying to keep it at $50 to $60. There was an opportunity about 5 to 7 years ago if cable companies would do a la carte programming, so I could pick the Home and Garden channel or History Channel or HBO and pick the channels I wanted, I can keep my pricing more reasonable. They didn't. You had to buy 500 channels. And so this is a new world, and we're gonna see what consumers are gonna do and whether they're willing to pay more when those prices increase.
A la carte programming.
A la carte programming.
Thank you so much, Miro Copic with Bottom Line Marketing and SDSU.
Thanks, Maya.